Good morning, respected principal Dr. S. Kalaichelvan sir, respected professor A. Balasubramanian sir, learned participants, fellow colleagues and student friends. It is indeed a great pleasure in welcoming you all for this thought-provoking and informative webinar series, Water Chemistry Interpretation Methods Part 2. In succession to the overwhelming response to the first part, we today present you the second part on the important element of earth, water. Continuing his lecture, Professor A. Balasubramanian sir today moves further in the water chemistry interpretation methods, especially in this era of technology and growth. We welcome you, sir. Your vast experience and unborn knowledge will definitely benefit us. It is an absolute pleasure and opportunity to hear your lecture, sir. On behalf of Department of Geology, Government Arts College, Autonomous Salem 7, we welcome all the learned participants, researchers and student friends to this webinar series with great pleasure. Now I request Dr. V. Thirumurugan to say few words on our expert speaker. Thank you.
I extend a very good morning to all present in this live session. It is indeed a great honor to present a few words on our expert speaker, Professor Dr. A. Balasubramanian sir. Our professor is a Vikram Sarabhai Lifetime Achievement Awardee for Excellence in Education Communication in the year 2008 from the Government of India. Professor A.B. sir is known throughout the teachers and researchers for his good heart and ever-helping scientific acumen. Born in a simple, educated family, he has completed his PG Geology from Annamalai University in the year 1980. And he has got his PhD from the University of Mysore during 1989. Professor has a PDF to his credit from the James Cook University, Australia in experimental and numerical simulation in the year 1992. Sir has started his teaching career as an assistant professor from the Department of Geology, VOC College, Chittagong in the year 1981 and has served there till 1994. He joined the Mysore University as a professor of geology in 1994 and has served the university in various capacities till now. Professor A.B. sir has a PG teaching experience of about 29 years, UG teaching of 14 years, research experience of about 24 years, and his administrative experience runs to about 22 years. Professor A.B. sir has guided about 25 research students for their research degrees and has successfully completed more than 15 research projects. Sir has many firsts to his credits. He is the founder of the UGC Center for Information Science and Technology, CIST, at the University of Mysore and has established the Education Multimedia Research Center, EMMRC, in the Mysore University. Professor A.B. sir has published 2 books and has about 105 research papers published in various research journals of repute. On the administrative side, our professor has served the University Grants Commission of our country in various capacities. The Professor Tyagarajan Committee on UGC Guidelines for PhD in Universities and Colleges is one to cite. He has served as the member of the UGC InfluNet Committee also. Professor has served the NAC as a member of the peer team and expert committees for various NAC related activities. Professor A. Balasubramanian sir has served the Pondicherry University as its Pro Vice Chancellor for the period of 2008 to 2010. Professor has served the University of Mysore in almost all the administrative capacities as Vice Chancellor in charge, administrative offices like Dean and Chairman, and member and chairman to the Council for Research and Academic Councils. Professor has officiated as an advisor to the Maldives government in water and sanitation. The original CV of our professor runs to about 100 pages with no repetitions, and we feel this information stands a testimony to credit our expert speaker, Professor A. Balasubramanian sir. Time compels us to start our expert session, and I feel privileged and honored to invite our sir to take over the session. Welcome, sir. Thank you.
Namaskar. I welcome you all to the second session on water chemistry interpretation methods. This session has been organized by the Department of Geology, Government Arts College, Salem. The water chemistry interpretation methods are much needed aspects in domestic uses, agricultural uses, and industrial uses. People study about this in the subjects like aquatic geochemistry, hydrogeochemistry, and environmental geochemistry. Scholars normally attempt to do their research using water chemistry data due to some specific reasons. Number one, it is easy to do. Number two, all the approaches are straightforward approaches, and there are no ambiguity in the calculations and interpretations, and there are wide spectrum of application areas available using very little data, ionic concentration data of water chemistry. That is why many people prefer working on hydrogeochemistry. I hope that you are all aware of the importance of water chemistry in various activities. Most of the domestic, industrial, and agricultural activities use water invariably. Water is used as a carrier of reagents. The chemistry of industrial process water is a major concern. Monitoring the quality of wastewater discharged from the industrial areas is yet another issue of concern. For purification, treatment, disinfection, and softening, many chemicals are used in the processes. The chemical hazards in drinking water itself is a major problem. Corrosion and scale formation and treatment for corrosion control, they also need much attention. The chemicals from industrial sources, chemicals from human dwellings, and chemicals from agricultural activities may change the quality of water. There are several kinds of water chemistry interpretation methods available for our use. They are very simple range-based classification, very simple calculation of parameters, empirical properties calculated using indices, ratios, etc., simple graphical plots like Collins bar graph, stiff diagram, pie diagram, etc., graphical plots using percentage data like Piper diagram and Dyroff's diagram, partly empirical and partly graphical methods like USSL classification diagram, and fully numerical methods using thermodynamic databases. There are several kinds of water chemistry interpretation methods available for use. They are simple range-based classification, simple calculation of parameters, empirical properties like indices, ratios, etc., simple graphical plots like Collins bar graph, stiff diagram, pie diagram, and all, graphical plots using percentage data in Piper and Dyroff's diagrams or Honda's classification diagram, partly empirical and partly graphical methods like USSL diagram, and fully numerical methods using thermodynamic databases. In the previous session, we have seen some simple calculation methods related to hardness, calcium hardness, magnesium hardness, carbonate hardness, non-carbonate hardness, alkalinity, corrosivity ratio, Reisner's stability index, Larsen-Skold index, Pucorius scaling index, chloroalkaline indices, and calculation methods related to Squalene's water type, exchangeable sodium ratio, pollution index, residual sodium carbonate, sodium adsorption ratio, and simple methods like Stuyvesant's classification, chloride-based classification, the permeability index calculation of donene, von Wirdum ion ratio, base exchange index of water, Kelly's index of water, acid neutralizing capacity of water, and many more indices. In this session, let us see some more applications of water chemistry data. The topics of importance in applied aquatic chemistry are drinking water quality and treatment, boiler feed water chemistry and treatment, chemical treatment processes, and water softening. In terms of chemical additive compounds, the most commonly used additives are quick lime and hydrated lime. In terms of water softening, we use chemicals like soda ash and lime, which is calcium hydroxide. Water softening is an important process in several water use related applications. Chemical precipitation is one of the commonly employed methods for water softening. The chemicals normally used are lime, that is calcium hydroxide, and soda ash, that is sodium carbonate. Lime is used to remove compounds that cause carbonate hardness. Soda ash is used to remove compounds that cause non-carbonate hardness. When hydrated lime is added to a bicarbonate water, this type of reaction happens. When calcium hydroxide is added to calcium bicarbonate water, calcium carbonate is formed along with water. The hardness-causing minerals form nearly insoluble precipitates. Calcium hardness is precipitated as calcium carbonate as per this equation or reaction. When hydrated lime is added to magnesium bicarbonate water, magnesium hardness is precipitated as magnesium hydroxide. This relationship is shown very clearly using these equations. When soda ash is added, calcium carbonate is precipitated, sodium sulfate is precipitated, and sodium chloride is also precipitated. These equations are shown to demonstrate how the role of soda ash and lime are helpful in water softening. The principle of water softening is very important. For each molecule of calcium bicarbonate hardness removed, one molecule of lime is used. For each molecule of magnesium bicarbonate hardness is removed, two molecules of lime are used. For each molecule of non-carbonate calcium hardness removed, one molecule of soda ash is used. For each molecule of non-carbonate magnesium hardness removed, one molecule of lime plus one molecule of soda ash is used. These are the equations governing the lime and soda ash additions to water. When we attempt to calculate the quantum of additions or doses, the following equations are to be considered. Some dissociation constants are used in these equations. The sample calculation carried out to determine the lime dosage in water softening is shown in this illustration. We are showing a sample, a groundwater sample with a pH of 7.72. Calcium is 200 mg per liter. Mg is 132 mg per liter. Temperature is 20 degrees Celsius. Alkalinity is 311. Total hardness is 332. Because of that, carbonate hardness is equal to alkalinity, which is equal to 311 mg per liter as CaCO3. So non-carbonate hardness is equal to total hardness minus alkalinity, which is equal to 21 mg per liter as CaCO3. From the above values, we know that it is an excess lime soda ash process. This bar graph shows the hardness and salinity values. The calculation involves three steps. In the step 1, assume that pH is equal to 7 So all alkalinity is in the bicarbonate form. So we calculate the constants, dissociation constants or ionization constants K1 and K2 using the values available with us. So here K1 and K2 are the ionization constants. At the end of this, we calculate alpha 1 and alpha 2, carbon total, and finally HCO3. The equation to be used for calculating alpha 1 is shown here, and the equation to calculate total carbon is also shown here, and finally we calculate CaCO3. If you look at the bar graph once again and use the HCO3 calculated just now previously in the previous calculation method, the total calculation comes like this. In the step 3, finally we compute the lime dose requirement and soda ash dose requirement. The calculations pertaining to lime dosage and soda ash dosage, they are given in this step 3. Swimming pools are very important places where water quality changes every day. Swimming pools pose risk to human health, largely in the form of exposure to microbial pathogens and disinfection byproducts. If you look at this pH distribution diagram, the swimming pool water chemistry belongs to only 7. And all chemicals used in treatment are beyond 8. If you see this diagram of alkalinity in swimming pools, pool chemistry should be within the range required. In water, when pH is more than 8.3, carbonate will be present compulsorily. So this diagram shows very clearly how pH and alkalinity are related to each other pertaining to bicarbonate and carbonate. Swimming pool water treatment is an important area of concern. Swimming pool water should be safe. It needs frequent treatment to maintain the water in a safe and pleasant condition for swimming. We need to keep the water free of pathogenic harmful bacteria. We need to keep the swimming pool water free from growth of algae. We need to ensure that the water is neither toxic nor irritating to the swimmers. It has to be prevented from the formation of undesirable smells or taste in the water. We need to prevent corrosion of the pool surroundings, its fittings and equipment. We need to prevent the scale formation in the pool, filters and pipe works. Students can learn the importance of pH in water chemistry because pH affects chlorine sanitation and calcium balance. The effect of pH on chlorine disinfection, adjusting pool pH to increase the pH, sodium carbonate should be used. Sodium bicarbonate will increase total alkalinity but will not move the pH efficiently. And understand the pool water chemistry. Chemical contaminants in swimming pools, their occurrence, implications and control are very important aspects. This diagram shows the water flow controls and addition of chemicals in swimming pools. This diagram shows the addition of chlorine in swimming pools. Chlorine gas is sprayed over the pool surfaces. Salt index calculation is another important method of interpreting water chemistry data. Calculation of salt index uses sodium and calcium concentrations in ppm as CaCO3. Once the salt index is calculated, if it is found to be negative, the water is said to be very good quality water. The solubility of calcium carbonate versus temperature are shown in this figure. The solubility of calcium carbonate increases with increasing temperature. This is a very important relationship which we have to understand. Non-marine ion calculations are important calculations done using water chemistry data. The equations shown here, they help to calculate the non-marine calcium, magnesium, sodium, sulfate and potassium. The oxidation capacity of water is yet another parameter. Advanced oxidation processes were first proposed for potable water treatment in the year 1980. The oxidation capacity of water is calculated in milliequivalents per liter. Here we are seeing 8 samples and their oxidation capacity values. The first two are rain waters, then we have lake water, then 5 and 6 are groundwater, and 7 and 8 are salt water, seawater. We can very clearly see that the oxidation capacity increases for salt water. The non-sea salt values of ions in water can also be calculated. Precipitation samples collected at stations influenced by oceanic air masses contain sulfur from both marine and non-marine sources. So we can easily calculate the non-marine sources of calcium, magnesium, potassium, bicarbonate, chloride and sulfate using these formulas. Seawater intrusion detection can be done using a ratio. It is called saltwater intrusion ratio or seawater intrusion ratio. This is the equation which helps to calculate that. Once the saltwater intrusion ratio is calculated, we can find out the important significance out of that. If the intrusion saltwater intrusion cork saltwater contamination ratio is less than 0.5, it is a normal groundwater. There is no saltwater contamination. And gradually, if it goes up and up, and if it is between 6.6 and 15.5, the water is highly contaminated. It must be seawater freshwater interface. When the saltwater intrusion ratio goes beyond 15 to up to 125, it is seawater. And if it goes beyond 125, it is almost brine. Here we are seeing the saltwater seawater intrusion ratio of the 8 samples. First two are rainwater, second two are lake water, then we have groundwater, and last two are seawater. We can very clearly see that they are all above 125. There are a lot of numerical methods applicable for water chemistry data. They involve extensive calculations using standard equations and table values. Water formed scales in pipes is a typical problem in many places. It is also more in Salem district also. Scale and scale deposit control are very important in cooling systems because of their effects on the heat transfer, corrosion of metals, and fouling of cooling tower film fills. Most of these compounds are calcium based, with the two most common being calcium phosphate and calcium carbonate. Most common cooling water scales, calcium phosphate, calcium carbonate, silica, calcium sulfate and calcium fluoride. The saturation indices of dissolvable mineral species like calcium carbonate calculation is very important. Calcium carbonate saturation index is a very widely used parameter, especially when we analyze groundwater or hard water. 6 to 7 methods of approaches are available for finding them. These methods do not use any thermodynamic databases. They are very simple numerical methods. The three typical methods used for saturation index calculations are shown here. The first one is Langlier's saturation index calculation, where pHa is the actual pH measured and pHs is the calculated saturation pH, which is determined using the equation pHs is equal to 9.3 plus A plus B minus C plus D. The A, B, C, D are coefficients. We can calculate them from the table values. The second method is saturation index, which is equal to pH actually analyzed plus temperature factor plus calcium factor plus alkalinity factor minus 12.1. The last one is also similar to Langlier's saturation index, but the procedure of calculating pH under saturation, pH saturation level pH, is equal to pK2 minus pKs plus pCa plus pAlk. Here pK2 is a constant and pKs is also a constant, which can be calculated based on the properties of water. And pCa and pAlk are also calculated from the ionic concentrations like calcium and alkalinity. Let us see the calculation methods. Langlier's CaCO3 saturation index is calculated to understand these issues. In the 1930s, Langlier developed the first set of calculations for this purpose. Calcium carbonate precipitation is dependent not only on the calcium and alkalinity in solution, but also on the pH analyzed, that is pH actually measured. So LSA is equal to pHa minus pHs. pHs is the saturation pH, which is calculated using this equation. Simplified method for pHs is shown here. LSA is equal to pHa minus pHs. The values for A, B, C and D can be found in a standard table. From the table, values are derived and applied here. Here, temperature is shown in Fahrenheit. Two approaches are adopted in water chemistry. One is the saturation index calculation using this formula. The second one is the stability index of Reisner. If you see that stability index of Reisner, the first part of this equation, first part is multiplied by 2. So it means the values will be slightly higher than the saturation indices. Let us see how the calculations are done for the first formula. The step one is for computation of coefficient A and B, constants A and B. For that we use Ca in ppm, HCO3 in ppm, total dissolved solids in ppm. So A is calculated using this formula. Then B is calculated using the temperature in Kelvin. And then in step 2, C and D constants are calculated using Ca. Then for D calculations, HCO3 values are used. Then in step 3, Langlier saturation index is calculated using that formula by substituting the values of A, B, C, D. If you see here, the saturation pH calculated out of this comes to be 7.99. The actual pH is 8.3. So the Langlier's calcium carbonate saturation index for this case is 0.309. If LSA value is positive, then the water is saturated and it will tend to deposit. If LSI value is positive, the water is saturated and will tend to deposit calcium carbonate and is a scale forming non-aggressive water. If the LSI value is negative, then the water is not saturated and will dissolve calcium carbonate and it will be aggressive. If PHS is equal to pHa, then the water is balanced. The advantage of Langlier saturation index is we can calculate with increasing temperature and find out at what time the saturation is happening, scale formation is happening, and at what time corrosion is happening, and all these stages which we wanted to know can be identified using this Langlier saturation index. Another method for determining the saturation index is using temperature factor, calcium factor, and alkalinity factor. This is the equation: Si is equal to pH plus temperature factor plus calcium factor plus alkalinity factor minus 12.1. The saturation index, if it is zero, then the water is balanced. If it is positive, it is scale forming, and if it is negative, it is corrosive and aggressive. This is also a simple method for finding saturation index. For a sample, let us see how it works. The pH is 7.7, temperature is 29 degrees Celsius, alkalinity is 100 mg per liter, calcium hardness is 200 mg per liter. You may see the illustrative example shown in this table. We can find out what is the temperature factor, what is the alkalinity factor, and what is the calcium factor. And if you substitute all these factors to that equation Si, in this case we get a value of 0.2. The saturation index and Reisner's stability index are two different concepts. And I have already mentioned that Reisner's stability index calculates pHs into two times minus pHa. If you analyze this equation, if you substitute the values and calculate, the Reisner's stability index here in this case comes to be 7.5. If you see the significance of that, if the Reisner's index is found to be 7.5, and if we look at the range values, 7.5 to 9.0, it is strongly corrosive water. So these range values help to determine the level of impact created by the water using that Reisner's stability index. The same 8 water samples collected from 8 different environments, the Reisner stability index values are shown here. The first two are river water, then next two are lake water, then next two are groundwater, then the last two are seawater samples. If you see the range values, the river water has got the highest and the seawater has got the lowest. And you can see the significances by the side of this. We are seeing the significances. For this particular sample of 7.5, again, Reisner stability index shows that it is significantly corrosive. Reisner's stability index is illustrated in this figure. Scientists have compared the samples with the level of corrosion. And you can see that the x-axis shows the samples, y-axis shows the Reisner's stability index, and then the level of the corrosion, the level of incrustation or scale forming level, all are shown in this one single graph for the samples collected and analyzed by the scientists. Students' classroom exercise can also be given using these types of diagrams. The next method is calcium carbonate saturation index by Stiff-Davis method. Here the equation pHs is equal to pK2 minus PKS plus PCA plus P alk. PHS is the Langlier's saturation pH. PK2 is the second dissociation constant for carbonic acid, and PKS is the solubility product constant for calcium carbonate. We can calculate the solubility product constant for calcium carbonate, calcium sulfate, and different mineral species separately. Two parameters are needed in this method: PK2, which is a calculated constant, PKS, C is the constant for calcite, PKSS is the constant for aragonite, PCA is the negative log of the CA concentration, and PALK is the negative log of the alkalinity concentration as based on a titration procedure. In this table, we are seeing the temperature ranges, PK2 values, PKS calcite values, PKS aragonite values, PKS vatirite values, and PKW, then AA. And the calculation procedure is very simple. We can directly calculate using these values, or we can also use a nomograph to calculate these values. The pH is 8.3, PK nu value is 2.7, PCA is 3.3, PALK is 2.4. So Stiff Davis saturation index is minus 0.2. Positive means scale forming, negative means corrosive. Stiff Davis saturation index is a very important one because the effect of temperature can be calculated. This table shows the calculated values of saturation index for varying temperatures. You can see at the last column, the values are gradually shifting from negative to positive. Another method is shown here, that is that temperature factor, calcium factor, or zinc factor method. Table values of all factors can be seen here. And the results are calculated like this. Using all the factors, the saturation index is found to be 0.056. We can also do comparative analysis of various methods using their results. Total dissolved solids versus saturation index values are also plotted to know the nature of solubility of various minerals. Ionic strength calculations are very essential steps involved in water chemistry. Ionic strength is a measure of the concentration of ions in that solution. Ionic compounds, when dissolved in water, dissociate into ions. The total electrolyte concentration in solution will affect important properties such as the dissociation constant or the solubility of different salts. Ionic strength of every ion and the whole sample can be calculated using this equation, in which Ci refers to the concentration of the ith ion. This table shows the unit conversions of ionic concentrations into moles. And finally, the ionic strength calculations are done for all the ions. This illustration shows how ionic strength is reflected in various samples. The next important aspect in aquatic geochemistry is the calculations of activity coefficients of ions. The important steps adopted are as follows. First, we have to calculate the ionic strength. Then, using ionic strength values, we can calculate the activity coefficients of individual ions. For that, we may use Debye-Huckel equation or extended Debye-Huckel equation or Davis equation. These formulas use two temperature dependent constants as A and B. Then the AI values shown here are the atomic radii or ionic radii, and the Z value is the charge of the ion, and I you know as the ionic strength. Activity coefficients calculations are simple procedures. It requires ionic strength and temperature of water. The A and B constants for various temperatures of water samples and the atomic radii AI for various ions can be obtained from these tables. These are standard values. They are very simple and we can find them in textbooks. They have given the ranges, but we need to find out the correct values for correct temperatures. The activity coefficients calculation steps are shown here ion wise. The Debye-Huckel A and Debye-Huckel B values of A and B constants for a particular temperature are shown here, and ARI is the ionic radii, and the last column shows the activity coefficients calculated as per Debye-Huckel equation. The values of ionic strength and activity coefficients of various ions are normally plotted and interpreted like this. The activity coefficients ion wise are also compared as shown in this diagram. The next important aspect in hydrogeochemistry is the speciation modeling. We call it as geochemical modeling of water. Many mineral species are soluble in water. Some of them, if dissolved more, become saturated and try to settle as precipitates or form scale deposits in the vessels and pipes. If we know the level of saturation, then we can find out three major things. One is which type of ionic pairs have become oversaturated in water, due to which these precipitates are coming out. And number two is, if some mineral species are saturated in a body of water when it was flowing, we can say clearly, based on its chemistry, that this water will form scales in future or when used in boilers. Or, if they are corrosive agents, we can say that the water will be corrosive. The third point is, which of the available minerals got dissolved in the water from the source rocks or soils along their flow path can also be identified. Of course, not all mineral species are dissolvable. Only a few of them may be dissolvable and others may not. Geochemical modeling of hydrologic systems is an area of active research. It has potential applications to solve many problems, including those of environmental impact assessment, ecohydrology, thermodynamics of minerals, acid mine drainage analysis, and industrial waste effluent analysis. The results can be used to validate our conceptual understanding of hydrologic flow regimes and geochemical processes. The computational process involves simulation of geochemical reactions by combining the theory of aqueous chemistry with extensive thermodynamic data. This concept of studying the geochemistry of natural water systems was introduced by Garrels and Thomson in the year 1962. The basic chemical units used in geochemical models are as follows. In physical chemistry, we express units of concentration in terms of normality, in terms of molality and in terms of molarity. Here we use mostly the molality, that is the molal concentration of ions. In order to do that, the formula shown here is used, and this formula is very simple. M is equal to ppm divided by gram formula weight multiplied by 1000, or ppm value of the ion multiplied by 0.001 divided by gram formula weight. The given table here shows the sample calculations made for Ca, Mg and Na. These Mi values are used for ionic strength calculations. Using thermodynamic databases, it will be possible to compute the saturation indices of mineral species. For this purpose, we need major ion concentration data, water temperature data, then the Gibbs free energy of formation data available from textbooks. Using the above set data, we need to calculate ionic strength, solubility product, then ion activity product. These three values are very important. The law of mass action should be kept in mind for this. A reversible chemical reaction can be represented by the law of mass action equation, where A plus B is equal to C plus D, where A, B, C and D are the stoichiometric coefficients of the reactants AB and the products CD, or the reactants ABCD. At equilibrium, the concentrations of the products and the reactants are constant. We need to understand the following general equations. G is equal to H minus TS, where G is the Gibbs free energy, T is the temperature, H is the enthalpy, that is the heat constant, and S is the entropy. Delta GR, DGR is equal to G of products minus G of reactants. Natural logarithm of KEQ, that is K at equilibrium constant, is equal to minus delta GR divided by RT, where R is the gas constant and T is the temperature. So logarithmic value of KEQ is equal to minus DGR delta GR divided by 2.303 RT. KEQ is the proportionality or equilibrium constant. KEQ is the proportionality or equilibrium constant. For dissolution of a solid in water or other electrolytes, it is known as the solubility product, KSP. The equation that governs the relationship between KEQ at delta GR at a temperature of a sample are shown here. Delta GR is the Gibbs energy of the reaction, K is the equilibrium constant, T is the temperature, and R is the gas constant. The stages of calculations are like this. First, we have to calculate the solubility product KSP, then ion activity product IAP, and then we can compute the saturation index of the mineral species using SI is equal to IAP divided by KSP. It should be done in logarithmic forms because most of the values are in moles form. Let us understand the calculation of KSP. KSP is calculated using thermodynamic databases, or we can use directly the table values available from textbooks. The KSP, solubility product of anhydride, is shown here. Let us also calculate the equilibrium constant solubility product of anhydride at 25 degrees Celsius. Given the balanced reaction CaSO4 is equal to Ca plus SO4, we can do this. This illustration shows you the methodology. Delta GR, that is DGR calculation step, is shown here. Simple additions and subtractions are the work involved in this. If you see that, the DGR delta G of CaSO4 and CaSO4 anhydride are shown in the first column. That is to be used for calculating the solubility. DGR is equal to DGCA plus DGSO4 minus DGCaSO4. The first column values, DG values are used here in order to find out a delta GR. Finally, we get 21.68 kJ per mole. The next step is, using DGR values, we can calculate K equilibrium, that is solubility product, KSP. Minus DGR divided by 5.708, that is the gas constant multiplied with temperature, we get the result of 10 to the power of minus 3.8. In this calculation, we can see that at the end. The equilibrium constant or solubility product of anhydride at 25 degrees Celsius is 10 to the power of minus 3.8. The next step is the calculation of ion activity product. This should be calculated based on ionic concentrations from water chemistry data of the samples. We need activity coefficients of ions and molality of ions. One more example is shown here from Tuxan Basin well water chemistry data. You can see the data shown in different columns. The activities of Ca, SO4 and HCO3 are calculated and shown here. Ion activity product is calculated easily using the following steps. We need to use ions in moles. That should be multiplied by activity of ions, and that product should be multiplied with similar products of other participating ions, ionic pairs. For example, for calcite related analysis, we have to multiply molality Ca with activity of Ca. That is multiplied with molality of carbonate with activity of carbonate. That's all. So MCa multiplied by YCa, then MCO3 multiplied YCO3, and both are multiplied together to get CaCO3. The details of calculations are as follows. This illustration shows the activity calculations for Ca, SO4 and HCO3 in step 1. Then using these values in step 2, IAP is calculated. That IAP is divided by the K equals, that is K equilibrium solubility product of anhydride, which we have already seen earlier. The result of IAP divided by KSP is the saturation index of anhydride. With calculators, we can do all these calculations. Students can do classroom exercises very easily using these methodologies. Water temperature is one factor used in ion activity product and KEQ calculations. KEQ varies when temperature varies. For finding the KSP, that is KEQ at a different temperature, Van der Hoff expression is used. If the temperature ranges between 0 degrees Celsius and 50 degrees Celsius, the Van der Hoff expression can be used to extrapolate the equilibrium expression to find out the new KSP at different temperature T2. HR is the standard enthalpy, which you might have seen in the previous tables. HR is the standard enthalpy taken from the thermodynamic data and used for this calculation. The calculation of solubility of gypsum at 25 degrees Celsius is shown here. Finally, log KEQ is shown here. The illustration for anhydride for 65 degrees Celsius is shown here. Slightly we are extrapolating to 65 degrees using the same Van der Hoff equation. We are extrapolating it to 65 degrees. Here you can see the thermodynamic database The first column of CaSO4 and CaSO4 is delta G, that is DGR. The second column shows delta H, that is DH. For these calculations, the DH values are used instead of DG values. Delta H values are used. You can see the illustration shown here for calculating the delta HR. Then using the value of R, we can calculate the KSP at 65 degrees Celsius. This is a very simple method which can help you to find out if the temperature is raised, what will happen to the mineral species present in the solution or water sample. This also holds good in boiler waters, pressure cookers, and then many temperature related boiling processes. The mineral species considered for these types of calculations are almost 2 dozen in numbers. This table shows the standard thermodynamic constants as table values available for our calculations. Example calculations are shown as model 1 here. You can see the calculation steps adopted. The illustration is for aragonite KSP. Aragonite is a product of Ca plus CO3, and the thermodynamic values are used appropriately here. The DGR values are calculated. DGR values are used and calculated for computing the KSP values. Then the ion activity product calculations for aragonite using one sample water chemistry data is shown here. From ppm to molality, then from molality values to ionic strength, then activity coefficient values in logarithmic formats are calculated and shown in the form of a table. Then finally, the ion activity product is calculated and divided by KSP to get SI. All these things are shown here. If SI is greater than 0, the mineral is supersaturated and can precipitate. If SI is equal to 0 or nearing 0, the mineral is in equilibrium with that solution. If SI is less than 0, the mineral is undersaturated and will dissolve if present. Saturation indices of many of these mineral species can be calculated with calculators. All this could be done only by using 10 major ion chemistry data. If data of metallic elements are available, then the number of parameters increase into 3 times of this. It means instead of 2 dozen, we can go up to 6 dozen. Climate change impact analysis is one important area. If the water temperature is increased due to climate change effects, then the dissolution rate, saturation indices, and precipitation rates of mineral species will change slowly. To find out the effects on water bodies directly, or to know how temperature change has already modified the chemistry of water bodies, we can use these methods. Hydrogeochemistry is a very interesting subject. For every solution, that is water or an electrolyte, there will be a lot of problems due to mixing, adsorption, dissolution, precipitation, and many more processes. For every problem, there are numerical solutions. All numerical approaches are very simple in the water chemistry interpretation methods. It is a very wide and complicated subject, but very easy to understand. There are plenty of things to be known in water chemistry interpretation methods. The available methods are very exhaustive. We have seen only a few. I thank all the faculty members of Government Arts College, Salem, especially the geology department teachers, Dr. Thirumurugan, Dr. Thirukumaran and others, and also the principal of the college for their organizational arrangements. I thank all the participants who have attended this module online. Let us see how to perform all these calculations and interpret the results using WatchIt software written by me in the next session. Thank you very much.
It is a great pleasure to propose word of thanks. Good afternoon. Happiness leads to thankfulness. I join with everyone to express our sincere thanks to expert speaker Professor A. Balasubramanian sir, University of Mysore, for the informative and research intuitive lecture sessions. Thank you, sir. Sir has taken no second in accepting our request, and the success of this webinar reveals the time and research he has invested in this lecture. The Department of Geology feels proud for the organization of this session. Thanks will be a small word for this lecture, sir. Still, we stand to thank you for this excellent and great lecture, sir. Thanks to the learned researchers, academicians, scientific technocrats, and student friends for their response to this session. Thanks, sir, due to our patron and principal, sir. Thanks to the team, EMMRC, University of Mysore, especially Sri Devendran and Sri Bhanupratap, for the technical support. Thank you all. The feedback form link will be shared through your email, and e-certificate will be sent separately. Thank you.